Okay, how about we get started? And we'll open with prayer. Father, we bless you today. We thank you for this opportunity that we have to come together and to study together, Father, and to learn from one another, learn from your word. And we pray that you would open our eyes, open our ears, open our minds and our hearts to receive everything that you have for us today. Father, I pray that you would help us to clearly understand the sacrificial system and what Yeshua did for us through his sacrificial death and resurrection, Father, and through his position as the high priest in the order of Melchizedek. Father, we pray that you would be in this class today and that you would help us to articulate thoughts clearly and help us to understand one another, and that you would be glorified in everything that we say. In the name of Yeshua, we pray. Amen. Okay, as a review, we're going to quickly go over a few things. Who can tell me the five types of sacrifices that we sort of started off our classes with a few weeks back? And those five types. The what? You can cheat. That's fine. The shilamim, that's the peace offering. What else? The chatat, the sin offering. The olah, the whole burnt offering or the elevation offering. That's a form of the shilamim. The mincha, which is the grain offering. And the last one? Asham, the guilt offering. Okay? So that's pretty much the categories there, and then other things sort of fall in those outside of what we talked about with the first fruits and the tithes and so forth. So, second is we started last week's class with this question. Now, I want to see if we came to a conclusion, if you guys can remember that conclusion. Why does an animal have to die for us to approach God? Shedding of the blood. Life is in the blood, right? So that blood, remember the laying on of hands, we invest our identity into the animal, and it acts as a proxy to bring us into the very presence of the Lord. And the blood of the animal represents our life, okay? Because the life is in the blood. Very good. Okay. Brings us up to the end of last week, the bulk of last week. We dealt with three problems of Yeshua setting aside the Levitical sacrificial system, okay? We said if it is true that Yeshua has completed the work, if he has done it all and there is no more, and therefore there is no more use for sacrifices and the Levitical sacrificial system, that presents three huge problems. Who remembers what those three problems were? Right. It causes a problem because you're having to throw out Torah, okay, which is at least half of Torah, if not three quarters of the Torah, to saying that it is no longer has any application, okay? So we are abolishing Torah. What's the other two? You know what? We need to get this mic going. Where's that microphone? I'm going to have you repeat that because I can't hear you.
My voice is also gone too from teaching this morning. No, actually, they were very good, but, you know, you have to entertain them.
There you go.
So it had something to do with the job of the priesthood and them not being able to carry out that perpetually.
Okay, that's actually tied to the first one, the Torah, okay, because their job is described in the Torah, and so they would be out of a job and so forth, and the commandments that apply to them would no longer be valid. So the abolishment of Torah, go ahead.
Was it the temple still existed and the apostles and the believers after Yeshua still went to the temple and participated in
those things.
Right. So the apostles continued to participate in the sacrificial system even after the death and resurrection of Yeshua, up until the destruction of the temple 40 years later. For 40 years, we have this continuation of just what's normal to them, and we don't realize that in our reading of the scriptures, in our studying of the scriptures, and we tend to just think that as soon as Yeshua, if I can get my voice working today, as soon as Yeshua died and resurrected, all of his followers just stopped doing all that because he did it all, okay? We have this misconception of that, but for 40 years, they continued that. They continued it as long as they possibly could, but with the destruction of the temple, they were no longer able to. Okay, so first problem, it abolishes Torah. Second problem, it's incongruent with the practice of the apostles and the disciples. What was the third one? Reggie, you can pass that mic.
It would fly in the face of prophecy.
There you go. It as he said, would fly in the face of prophecy. It would be... and I'm having trouble with the words again today, but we are still having prophecies that are still yet to be fulfilled, right? That involve the establishment of the temple and the sacrificial system. Ezekiel chapters 40 through 48 is the primary one that we need to look at there, right? And so these three things are huge problems if we just have a blanket statement that says Yeshua fulfilled it, therefore it's done away with, or we don't have to say it's done away with. Yeshua fulfilled it, it's no longer necessary. That's the same thing we're saying, but we're just using different words, okay? So these are the problems. Here is our last question before we get into today's topic. And we need to definitely pass the mic around for this. So I want to hear your initial reaction when you discovered that the disciples and apostles continued to participate in the sacrificial system, even after the death and resurrection of Yeshua. And the apostles. You're sitting there shaking your head. Tell me.
I was taught it was a cult. So I was like, what?
Right. So you're taught that the whole sacrificial system was, if anybody even thought about that from a contextual perspective of the apostles and disciples doing it, that was not Yeshua. So what was your reaction when you heard that the apostles continued to do it?
I wanted to know more. I wanted to, like, okay, why, how, tell me more.
Okay, so you've basically, this guy's made the statement, and now you've got to prove it to me. You got to show me. Show me the roll that beautiful bean footage, right? Anyone else? Anyone? Bueller? Right. Rephrase the question. What was your initial reaction when you were told that disciples and the apostles continued to participate in the sacrificial system, even after the death and resurrection of Yeshua? Did anybody have any, like, what?
How many people here already knew that?
Yeah, let's do that. So who already knew that ahead of time, okay?
Are you talking about prior to the class?
Prior to the class, okay? So about half the class, okay? So, Anyway, you know, when most people hear something like this, their initial reaction's like Amanda. You know, that is almost blasphemous, if not all, you know, 100% blasphemous. I mean, you know, we get this fear, we get this sort of outrage, we get this sort of all these emotions going based on this one statement, because we've been indoctrinated all of our lives, and it totally goes against what we have believed to be true, and this is a difficult thing. And so, you know, that's why I wanted to get some honest answers here to help us work through some of this. So, you know, last week we dealt with those three things, and knowing that the apostles continued this and it was just a normal part of their life and their routine, I think that's huge, especially for those of us who, we are here because we believe in Yeshua, the apostles, and the Torah. And that's the, sort of the things that bind us together, the apostolic writings, and the Torah, Yeshua, those are the three things that bind us together. And so now, today, I told you we would be working through some of these definitions of terminology. We're going to do that. And then one of the main things that we're going to be doing today is looking at Yeshua in the context of the ultimate sacrifice, okay? And try to understand exactly what he did when he laid down his life on our behalf, okay? So the first term that I want us to understand and work through together is the term sin. Okay, so what is a sin? Let me hear somebody what you've been taught the word sin means. What does it mean to sin? Okay, break a commandment. Anybody else? Missing the target, okay? Both of these are correct. The one Ruthie said, missing the target, is the more defined of the two. It's the more accurate as far as the word goes, but it does, you know, we could also say it means breaking the commandment, but it's more than this, okay? Sin is the same word as that we learned for the sin offering. It's the word chatat, okay? There's some nuances there, but for our purposes, chatat, okay? And so its first appearances we read about in Genesis 4 and 7. And this is where Hashem is talking to Cain, and he's trying to tell him his problem, that he's got a problem he's got to deal with, okay? And this is what the Lord tells Cain: if you do well, will you not be accepted? If you do not do well, sin is crouching at the door. Its desire is for you, but you must rule over it, okay? And before I continue on, there are a couple of different words used for sin. This could possibly be the first one, which is generally used through Genesis, and then from Exodus forward that uses the word katat. So, but the purpose that Hashem was trying to get across to Cain was that from the beginning, man's mission was to be in control, or to be master over his sin nature, over his flesh, right? And just as Rabbi Damon is talking about today, we are not animals. We have the ability to change, to develop, to have self-control, and so forth. We are not just, we are not bound to simply instinct, okay? We are a higher creation with a neshama resting within us, or actually, I should say, a higher being with flesh wrapping our neshamas. You know, I mean, that might be a better description there. So, sin, as Ruthie was saying, it's an archery term that means to miss the mark. Okay, so if the target is back there, the target is Torah. The target is God's instructions, as Melinda said here. And so, if we, you know, pull back the bowstring, and we look over here somewhere and shoot over here, we're not hitting the mark. We're completely missing the mark. But if we intently aim upon the target, shoot towards the target, hit that target, then that is what we're supposed to be doing. Anything outside of that is sin. So Paul in Romans 7, chapter 7, verse 7, he says, Torah defines sin. This is how he says it. If it had not been for the law or for the Torah, I would not have known sin. For I would not have known what it is to covet if the Torah, if the law, had not said, you shall not covet. Okay? So the Torah defines sin by saying, this is the standard, and don't go to the left and don't go to the right. Okay? So sin is departing from that standard, missing the mark. Okay, the second term we're going to look at is righteousness, okay? Righteousness, the Hebrew word tzedakah. And one of the misconceptions that we need to deal with in this is how a person, if a person can or cannot become righteous, okay, before Yeshua. Because I was told growing up that no one could be righteous. Because remember, we quote Isaiah, there is no one righteous, no, not one, right? But only after Yeshua came could someone be righteous. But this isn't the case, and this is taking that passage out of context. So Ezekiel 18 and Ezekiel 33 both deal with this concept of righteousness being attached to our actions, okay? Repentance brings about the forgiveness of sins. Righteousness is in the context of hitting that mark, okay? It says we are in right standing. Yeshua in both Mark, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, they all have quotes here of Yeshua saying that he has not come for the righteous, but for sinners. And a lot of times we take that as him being, you know, talking tongue-in-cheek, but he was being serious there, okay? Luke chapter 1, verses 5 and 6 is a description of John the Baptist's parents, Zechariah and Elizabeth. It says this, in the days of Herod, king of Judea, there was a priest named Zechariah of the division of Abijah, and he had a wife from the daughters of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth. And verse 6 says this, and they were both righteous before God, walking blamelessly in all the commandments and statutes of the Lord. Okay? And then we have a description in Luke 2:25 of Simeon, who has been longing to see Yeshua, the Messiah of Israel, and in waiting in anticipation for him. He was a priest. It says he was righteous and devout, and he was waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was upon him. So we have these passages in Genesis chapter, I think it's chapter 6, if I'm not mistaken. I don't know why I didn't write this down. Oh, there it is. There it is. Genesis 6, 9, Noah was a righteous man, blameless in his generation. He walked with God. So we have this declaration of righteous, a person being declared righteous. So righteousness, I want us to understand, is a legal status of right standing in the eyes of God. And it's particular to the covenant standard a person is obligated to. So for instance, Noah did not have the standard of Torah that, say, Isaiah did, okay? Because he didn't have the full revelation of the Torah. He had hints of it and so forth, but he did not have the complete standard. And that's why things, you know, it says Noah was righteous in his generation. And there's comparative, there's, you know, a lot of teaching, Midrash, on this, of how that is to be interpreted and so forth. But righteousness is the legal standing in the eyes of God of a person according to their obligation. Justification, you know, we look at as a separate term, but it's really the same term when it comes down to it as righteousness. But it's the sort of the verb form. Justification is the process by which a person is declared righteous. So it's simply the verb or the action associated with righteousness. It's from the same word, tzedakah. Atonement. Let's talk about atonement for a minute. Atonement is from the Hebrew word kafar, and it means to cover, as many of you guys, I'm sure, already know. And so in Exodus 29:36, we have the Lord telling Moses to purify the altar. It says, when you make atonement for it, and you shall anoint it and consecrate it, okay? And so this concept that something has to happen for this to this altar for it to be able to be made useful in God's presence, for it to even come into God's presence, okay? And so this atonement has to happen. So what is it? What is this atonement? You can think of it in this way. Maybe in the aspect of something like a shield. I mean, in terms of just sort of abstract, you know, thoughts here, a shield against the all-consuming fire of a completely holy God. We might think of atonement as a spiritual shield of sorts that protects a person or an object from the consequences of coming into the presence of the all-consuming nature of this divine being. Now, we often say, especially within church, we say that propitiation is something separate. We say atonement just means simply covering. Propitiation is something entirely different, but really the words are the same. They have the same meaning. It's simply the Greek expression of this concept rather than a concept that we consider, that we, you know, typically define as something superior. So atonement and propitiation are relatively the same. Last word before we get into our topic. Forgiveness. And Rabbi Damian dealt with this a couple of weeks ago in his message. He gave you Rabbi Twersky's definition of what forgiveness is not. If you remember that, it is not approving the action, okay? If you forgive somebody, you're not approving their action. You are not justifying their behavior. You are not necessarily reconciling with them. And you are not expecting an apology, because who knows if that day will ever come, right? So forgiveness is simply when your sins are not held to your account, okay? You're guilty, but your sins aren't held to your account, okay? You've been pardoned. This is another word for it. It's from the Hebrew word salach, okay? And we say every day in the Amidah, we say salach lanu avinu chichatanu. We say mechalanu malkenu ki fashanu. This is an expression that means forgive us, our Father, for we have sinned. Pardon us, our King, for we have transgressed, or we have willfully sin, something like that, okay? So forgiveness is to release or pardon. It's something that means our sins, again, or our actions in that regard, are no longer held to our account, okay? So I wanted to get those terminology out of our way and under our belt so we could, when we enter into these things, we're dealing with atonement and things like that, we'll all be on the same page. We may have to come back and refer to those again, okay? So let's talk about Yeshua as the ultimate sacrifice. So break out your Bibles to Hebrews, because the book of Hebrews is the book that we're going to be wrestling through passages here with. Yeah, the pinnacle of confusion. That's a great way to describe it. So Hebrews chapter 9 and verse 26, let's begin there. The second half of that verse. But as it is, he appeared, talking about Yeshua, once for all, at the end of the ages, to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. Okay? This is one of the places we get the concept that because of what he did, all this other stuff, you know, in Exodus, Leviticus, and so forth, has all been rolled under the carpet and is no more. Okay? Let's turn over to chapter 10. Probably just paragraph down there. And let's just read this whole little passage here from 1 to 14 so we can get the context. For since the law, the Torah, has but a shadow of the good things to come instead of the true form of the realities, okay, and by the way, we're all going to have different translations, and you'll notice how biased some of these translations are as we go along, okay? Words are inserted and so forth. It can never, by the same sacrifices that are continually offered every year, make perfect those who draw near. Otherwise, would they not have ceased to be offered, since the worshipers, having once been cleansed, would no longer have any consciousness of sins? But in these sacrifices, there is a reminder of sins every year. For it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. Consequently, when Christ came into the world, he said, "Sacrifices and offerings you have not desired, but a body have you prepared for me. In burnt offerings and sin offerings you have taken no pleasure. Then I said, 'Behold, I have come to do your will, O God, as it is written of me in the scroll of the book.'" Verse 8, "When he had said above, 'You have neither desired nor taken pleasure in sacrifices and offerings and burnt offerings and sin offerings,' these are offered according to the law. Then he added, behold, I have come to do your will. He does away with the first in order to establish the second. And by that will we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. And every priest stands daily at his service, offering repeatedly the same sacrifices, which can never take away sins. But when Christ had offered for all time a single sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God, waiting from that time until his enemies should be made a footstool for his feet. For by a single offering he has perfected for all time those who are being sanctified. Okay? So on the surface, this passage seems to say that Yeshua has replaced the sacrifices and the Levitical system. I mean, it really, on the surface level, that seems to be what it's saying, okay? But there are problems of this line of reasoning, and we've touched on these before. But one of the main problems that we need to deal with also is that Yeshua, okay, I'm waiting for the drum roll and the lightning. Yeshua did not qualify as a sacrifice within the sacrificial system. Okay? I know that sounds heretical, but let's think about it, okay? Yeshua did not literally function as a Levitical sacrifice. And in order to fulfill something, it has to literally happen. It has to really happen, okay? We can't just spiritualize it. If that were the case, we could each of us, we could fulfill really anything that we wanted to fulfill in the Torah, okay? So here are some examples of why this doesn't work. First of all, he is not from the herd or for the flock, according to Leviticus chapters 1, 11, and 22. He's not an animal. He's human, okay? So human sacrifices were an abomination to the Lord. They were never, ever, ever allowed to be presented to the Lord, okay? Second, by the time the Romans finished beating him, he was blemished. And therefore, he could not, even if he were an animal, if you take an animal out and beat it to death, and then try to take it to the priest to have it offered up, it would be rejected because it is blemished, okay? He was perfect before, but he was blemished before he went through his trial, okay? Before he was offered up. Third, he was not slaughtered in the temple. Okay? He was slaughtered outside the temple. Okay? And I just thought of another one that you know, we can relate to that. I've been using the word slaughtered. He died outside the temple. He was not ritually slaughtered. Okay? That's another one you can add in there. His death was not facilitated by a Kohen, a priest, okay? His blood was not poured out on the altar, despite some of the fantastical imaginations that we have within the Messianic movement, okay? I'm assuming some of you guys have heard some of that stuff about the blood trickling down and passing under where the Ark of the Covenant was hidden, going through the cracks and the rocks and all that kind of stuff, okay? But even if that were the case, you would have to have hundreds of gallons of blood for it to come all the way down and do something like that, okay? And so the blood was not poured on the altar. Next, nor was any of his body burned on the altar or given to the Kohen, okay? Neither one of those have come into play here. And his body was disposed of in an unclean place, okay? Things that have come into the holiness of the temple that were used as offerings to the Lord, they cannot be just discarded, okay? He was not a chatat, a sin offering, according to the biblical definition. He was not an olah, an elevation offering, or a whole burnt offering, nor a shelamim, a peace offering, nor a mincha, a grain offering, nor an asham, a guilt offering. So Yeshua's death does not conform to any of the standards that the Lord has established for the regulations according regarding the sacrifices. That was my next question. So the question is, what was he, and what did he accomplish? The ultimate and final sacrifice, okay? But we just got through saying, though, that he doesn't conform to any of these sacrifices. And so he cannot fulfill any of those. So he does fulfill something, but what is it? And that's what we're here to discover. So, look at what we just read, Hebrews 10:4. It says, "For it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins." Now, is this saying that it's not possible anymore for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins because Yeshua has done it all? No, it's saying it's just a fact. The blood of bulls and goats do not have the power or the ability to take away sins. That's not their purpose, okay? If you read down further, verse 11, "And every priest stands daily at his service, offering repeatedly the same sacrifices, which can never take away sins." But yet we have within the Torah, it says, if you do this, 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 you will be forgiven. What do we say forgiven was? You're pardoned. Your sins are not held to your account. So there's some kind of misunderstanding that we're not getting here, okay? And we've got to figure this out. So the blood of bulls and goats cannot take away sins. Not now, not then, not ever. The Levitical sacrifices were for the purification of the flesh. Look back at the chapter 9 in verse 13. It says, "For if the blood of bulls and goats, or goats and bulls, and the sprinkling of defiled persons with the ashes of a heifer sanctify for the purification of the flesh, how much more will the blood of Messiah, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without blemish to God, purify our conscience from dead works to serve the living God?" That should be like a big asterisk, star, highlighted passage of your Bible there, okay, if you do that sort of thing in your Bible, because that's going to be key, okay? The blood of bulls and goats are for a specific purpose. The blood of Messiah is for an entirely different purpose, and we have to make sure we don't try to make these two things do the same thing, because if they do the same thing, then we've got a huge problem again, okay? Because if the blood of bulls and goats could take away sin, think about that for a second. If the blood of bulls and goats really could, at one point, take away sin, then what's the point of Yeshua dying? Why would God put his son through something that awful if animals could do the job? Okay? That would mean that the Lord replaced the sacrificial system simply as a matter of convenience on our part. It would mean that Yeshua's sacrificial death was more on behalf of the animals than it was for us, because he died so the animals wouldn't have to die. Does that even make any sense? No. Okay? So, we have to realize that the blood of bulls and goats, as our text says, could never take away sins. Only sincere repentance could bring forgiveness, but neither repentance nor sacrifices could do the one thing that Yeshua could. And we're going to talk about that. Did you have a question, or anybody have a question before we go?
I was just relating it to something that I was thinking. If you were to get charged with a crime and you were to be pardoned by, say, the president or whatever, it doesn't mean the crime in itself has gone away. It just means that you don't have to take account of it. So just because, and I'm just making sure that's exactly what you're saying, right? Mm-hmm. So like, to be forgiven of a crime or to be pardoned of a crime doesn't mean that the crime comes off your record.
Right.
It will always be on your record, but in this case, you're just not having to serve time or do whatever you got to do to because you've been forgiven of it or you've
right.
been taken away from it.
Right. So you're in law enforcement, and so this will really hit home with you, I think. So what happens to a person that has been pardoned? Does that keep them from ever going back?
No.
No.
No, they can still commit the same crime and still go back. Just this, for this point in time, for that specific crime, for that specific instance, they are forgiven.
They don't pay the consequences at that time for that specific instance, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so that is one of the big factors that we're going to deal with when it comes to Yeshua, and we're going to have to hustle through this material, okay? So if Yeshua didn't qualify as a sacrifice for the Levitical system, then what did his death accomplish? That's what we're working on. How do we need to understand this, okay? So as we said earlier, the purpose of the Levitical sacrifices was dealing with what? The flesh, yeah, the flesh, earthly things, okay? We said in one of our early lessons that the whole concept of the korban was to do what? Draw near. Okay, this is the principle of the korban, to draw near. This allowed the worshiper to approach and interact with the Most High. It was, as we said, a transfer of the soul to the animal transfer of the soul through the blood of the animal to the Lord. Okay, and so we have this concept that we need to overcome as well. A lot of us have been raised in dispensationalism, okay? I'm sure you guys are familiar with that. It says there's basically seven dispensations, which most accountings say there's seven different dispensations, and the one prior to Yeshua was the dispensation of law, right? And now we're under this dispensation of grace, okay? That's how it goes. But unfortunately, that doesn't work, okay? That's man's categorization, that's man's theory, that's man's theology, trying to make things work. But that's not what God has said in his word. And so, you know, because we just got through talking about, it didn't work that the blood of bulls and goats took away sin previously, like we thought. And so therefore, we got a problem with this concept of how these dispensations play out, okay? And so Hebrews 9:13, as we just got through reading, talks about how Messiah is much more than the blood of bulls and goats that deal with the flesh, but his purifies the what? Conscience, okay? So, you know, are we talking psychology here? I mean, is the author of Hebrews a psychiatrist, psychologist, and dealing, you know, asking about your mother and all these Freudian things? No, I mean, when I read this text all my life, I'm like, dealing with the conscience. That is not normal biblical terminology, you know? It's not something that's typical biblical terminology that's throughout the scriptures, right? And so what is this word? And it turns out that it's a word that's pretty much equivalent to the soul. Okay, the neshama of a person. Okay, and so the one thing that Yeshua does has to do with how it affects our lives of who we are. That the blood of bulls and goats cannot do, has no power to do. Okay, as we were talking about Wesley, talking to Wesley with that one who has been pardoned, has the complete opportunity to return to that same sin and get thrown into the prison again, okay? But the blood of Yeshua transforms us into a new creation, right? So we are now a new creation. I'm gonna sidetrack because we need to learn some more concepts for just a moment. Let's talk about his suffering, okay? Because there's a concept called The Suffering of the Righteous that we need to understand to really fully understand what Yeshua has done for us. So, question for you guys is, outside of the seemingly obvious answer in regard to Yeshua, why do the righteous in general suffer? Why do righteous people suffer? Is it on? Because, I'll just repeat it, because of sin, okay? That's a great answer, okay? That's part of the answer. Now, deeper question, whose sin? Is it because of somebody else's sin, my sin, your sin, Adam's sin? I mean, how does this play out? Typically, we've been told, basically, that it's Adam's sin that has caused all this mess, okay? Judaism doesn't hold Adam accountable for the entire world's choices, okay? So the way we look at this within Judaism is that each person is responsible for their own choices, that sin entered into the world, but from that point, we are free moral agents. We are big boys and girls, in a sense, and we are responsible to make our own choices. And so, with God in His standard of justice, is He going to punish Ray for my sins? No, right? He is just. He's going to punish me for my sins and nobody else, okay? Ezekiel 18 is a primary example for this. If you want to flip over to this real quick, we can reference this. I won't read the whole thing. It's a little long, but this whole chapter is the explanation of the person who sins will die, okay? Let's begin. Let me find a good place to start here. You said 18?
That's the chapter.
Yeah, chapter 18. So, verse 14, now suppose this man's father, so it's going through the whole thing of a father being righteous and everything, and he is not punished, he's declared righteous. Let's go back to 10. But if the father has a son who is violent, a shedder of blood, who does any of these things, though himself he did none of these things, who even eats upon the mountains, defiles his neighbor's wife, oppresses the poor and needy, commits robbery, does not restore the pledge, lifts up his eyes to the idols, commits abomination, lends at interest, takes a profit, shall he live? Okay? The father is righteous. The son is doing all these abominable things. Okay? It's saying, will the son live? The answer is no. He shall not live. He has done all these abominations. He shall surely die. His blood shall be upon himself. And then it continues on that the father is not going to suffer on his behalf, okay? If the father does wrong, the son is not going to suffer on his behalf. The suffering is a one-to-one correlation of the sin that a person committed. Now, the problem is theory, principle, and reality oftentimes don't mesh. There's a saying that says, in theory, reality and theory should be the same, but in reality, they're not. And so what happens is, you know, we have righteous people in this world that suffer.
Yes, that's what's going to be my question.
Right. So that's a problem, right? So how do we reconcile this? If God is just and the righteous suffer, then how do we reconcile that?
There's physical consequences for our actions.
There's physical consequences for our actions, okay? So I think what you're talking about, correct me if I'm wrong, is if I've made a bad choice, but later on I repent, and maybe I stole or broke into a house, or I don't know, something like that, and then 10 years down the road, something comes out, and I have to pay the consequences for that, that's the physical reality of things. Is that what you're saying?
Right.
Okay.
You're saved. You're covered by the blood of Yeshua, Jesus Christ.
Right.
Physical sin, physical consequences, your soul, spirit, is a different story.
Right.
It moves on just like the thief on the cross.
Right. So, but what about those people who have not done any of those things, okay, that have done like Elizabeth, like Zechariah that we read about that said they were blameless in the eyes of the Lord, and they were righteous. But what happens when they suffer? This is still a problem. The problem is that it just doesn't seem fair because, you know, even the psalmist, even Jeremiah calls out, cries out to the Lord and asks the Lord about this. They said, it's not fair. It just doesn't seem right. You're God of justice, but you're letting these things happen. You are prospering the wicked and you are letting the righteous suffer. Has anybody ever seen that? Okay. Seen the wicked prosper and the righteous suffer. Okay. Jeremiah 12, 1 and 2 is a passage you can look up. I'm going to skip for now. Psalm 73 is another passage. Job is a prime example. Job chapter 21, you know, Job is crying out, saying, why are the wicked, you know, just prosper? You know, why are they, you know, being blessed and their houses are safe from fear? And God, you're not judging them. And then the next chapter, his friend, you know, basically says, well, the reason you're getting judged, the reason why you're having all these awful things happen to you is because you're actually really wicked. You just don't know it, okay? And so this punishment is because of something that you've done. And that's just not the case a lot of times, okay? So to reconcile this, we have this concept that the Pharisees introduced, that God does not mete out rewards and punishment fully in this life, okay? Rewards and punishments are meted out in the world to come fully, okay? And that's where we have the concept of and the doctrine of the resurrection and the judgment. Okay, I think we all in this room believe that, right? We inherited that from the Pharisees. The Sadducees did not believe that. They believed that they got what was coming to them in this life. If they were wicked, then there were, you know, punishment in this life. If they were righteous, then they got all the blessings. They got the fancy cars and so forth in this life. They got all the wealth and monetary, you know, blessings that they could handle. And that was their reward for their conduct and their righteousness and their standing with the Lord. But the Pharisees, on the other hand, realized that this was disproportional in this life, that oftentimes the wicked flourished and were blessed and prospered when the righteous suffered tragically. Okay? So the Talmud says, the Holy One, blessed be He, brings suffering upon the righteous in this world in order that they may inherit the world to come. So this is their explanation. The righteous suffer in this world, not because of anything that they've done, but because it's better to suffer in this world for a moment than a lifetime in eternal suffering in the world to come. Okay? But if the righteous aren't suffering for their own sins in this world, then whose sins are they suffering for? Because if they're righteous, then they are undeserving of suffering even still, right? And so the Pharisees said this. They said that the suffering of the righteous is on behalf of other people. The suffering of the righteous brings atonement. I'm going to read some passages from the Midrash and the Talmud. And if you don't have this, I highly recommend it. This is one of the things that we're basing this study on. It's called What About the Sacrifices by D. Thomas Lancaster. I'm going to read these sections from this book here. Talmud says, why is the story of Miriam's death placed next to the laws of the red heifer? This is to teach you that just as the red heifer brought atonement, so does the death of the righteous bring atonement. Why is the story of Aaron's death followed by the story of the transfer of his priestly garments? This is to teach you that just as the priest's garments were meant to bring atonement, so too the death of the righteous brings atonement. Here's a passage from the Midrash Rabbah. Rabbi Chia Bar Abba said, the sons of Aaron died on the first of Nisan. Why is their death mentioned in connection with the Day of Atonement? This is, if you aren't making the mental connection, the first of Nisan is the first of the year. The Day of Atonement is 6 months later. Okay, it's in the seventh, beginning of the seventh month. Why is their death mentioned in connection with the Day of Atonement? This is to teach you that just as the Day of Atonement brings atonement, so too the death of the righteous brings atonement. And how do we know that the death of the righteous brings atonement? From the fact that it is written in 2 Samuel 21:14, and they buried the bones of Saul and his son Jonathan, and after that God responded to the plea for the land. Okay? There's another passage in Tractate Berachot 62b. Rabbi Eliezer says, take a great man among them. Let me put it back in the context here. This is in Tractate Berachot 62b from the Talmud. Rabbi Eliezer tells a story in which the Lord tells the death angel, take a great man among them through whose death many sins can be atoned for them. Okay? So this is a rabbinic concept of one person being taken in atoning for others.
And realize Eliezer's relatively
contemporary. Right. Eliezer is relatively contemporary with the apostles. Okay? He's early 2nd century. Right? So Exodus Rabbah says, Moses said to God, will not the time come when Israel shall have neither tabernacle nor temple? What will happen with them then? Okay, so this is the concept that God is saying that if you guys cannot handle my presence dwelling among you and you continue to live in sin, I'm going to remove this structure from you. Same thing that Yeshua said. If you do not repent, then the holy temple, the dwelling place of God on earth, is going to be removed from you because I cannot stand to be in the midst of this sin, okay? So Moses asked the Lord, well, what if we don't have a temple or tabernacle? You know, what are you going to do then? The Holy One, blessed be He, replied, I will then take one of the righteous men and retain him as a pledge on their behalf in order that I may pardon all their sins. Okay? This book right here is called What About the Sacrifices?
That he just read is from Midrash, right?
Yes. Right. Okay, so let me find my place again here. To emphasize our point that we're making here is that the suffering of the righteous brings atonement. Okay, and therefore Yeshua, the only perfectly righteous human being to walk the planet, suffered on behalf of us. Okay,
there's an important
let's get the mic so we can hear.
You know, there's a tendency, of course, anyone who is listening to this class or who's not familiar with the Jewish rabbinic literature would say, every point they're making is being drawn from outside the Bible. I mean, sort of, because we're calling Midrash, we're calling Talmud, we're saying all this stuff. But the thing you have to realize is that these concepts were alive and well for the apostles who wrote the New Testament. I mean, the idea of the suffering of the righteous, I mean... these are contemporary with the apostolic writings. And so the idea that Yeshua would come as a suffering servant, as a righteous man suffering for the wicked, is not just something that was made up. This is from Jewish teaching that was well known and only became developed really even more later. But I think you can't miss the chronology to be able to connect this to what's going on in Hebrews and in the entire concept of Yeshua's death, burial, and resurrection.
Right. And so let me connect another dot here for us that I don't have my notes, but you just reminded me of this that I should have had in here. What happens when the nation as a whole rebels and goes against God's commandments that we see over and over again throughout the scriptures? What happens?
Exile,
judgment, okay, destruction, they're destroyed, right? He hauls them into captivity through one of their enemies, okay? Yeshua is, we call him the Messiah, okay, because we believe that he functioned as the Messiah. What is the Messiah, though? The anointed one, What is the anointed one? Basically, the king. Okay, this is how we need to recognize that title. When we say Christ, when we say Messiah, we need to think of terms of kingship, because that's his role. The anointed one, the one that has the anointing placed upon him to lead his people, Israel. When the king is functioning, he is acting on behalf of his people, Israel. If you notice, it doesn't matter what the people of Israel are doing, if they're doing good or bad or whatever. If the king does good, the nation is blessed. If the king does wickedness, the nation goes into exile. Okay? So Yeshua functions in this role, acting on behalf of the nation. So at this point, rather than the nation having to go through this long, horrid ordeal of destruction, exile, and so forth, we have 2,000 years of a type of exile, but not the exile that it could have been. Okay? Yeshua suffers as the Messiah on their behalf to take this consequence upon himself and the suffering upon himself. And he suffers on the behalf of his people. Hebrews that we just read, chapter 9 and verse 13 and 14, it says, as a reminder, if the blood of bulls and goats and sprinkling defiled persons with ashes of a heifer sanctify for the purification of the flesh, how much more the blood of Christ through the eternal Spirit offered himself without blemish to God, purify our conscience from dead works to serve living God. So not only is he suffering on our behalf, but he also is doing a work within us that the blood of bulls and goats cannot do. And this is what I was alluding to earlier. And here's a few more passages to back this up. Romans 8, verses 3 through 5. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do. Does that mean the law had flaws? No. It just means that the law had to interact and had to deal with humans that are imperfect. Okay? By sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin, he condemned sin in the flesh, in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit. So another thing that Yeshua's death does and resurrection is it empowers those who put their trust in him. Okay? When an animal dies, there is no spiritual, emotional, whatever connection to it. When our Messiah and the King of Kings has died, offered himself, we have this transcendent attachment to him that affects us completely in our identity of who we are, that Paul talks about, as I said earlier, being a new creation. And then last, in Jeremiah 31, we have the beginning of the fulfillment of the new covenant being coming into effect. It says, for this is the covenant I will make with the house of Israel after those days, declares the Lord. I will put my law, my Torah within them, and I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. If you know people who have truly come into a transforming encounter with Yeshua, they're not the same. And they begin walking in the Torah. I mean, whether that's, you know, I'm not saying, you know, they begin observing Sabbath or whatever, but if they're from a background that has nothing and all they know is what the church is teaching, whatever, even if they don't even know things about doctrine and so forth, their life starts to change. They're transformed. They can't help but to become something different and new and to become somebody that you would have never recognized weeks and months and years prior to that, okay? We need to wrap this up. So Yeshua's sacrifice can do what the Torah was unable to do. His sacrifice is able to bring perfect and complete atonement in order to bring lasting transformation to the worshiper. Not only do we have forgiveness and atonement, but we have reconciliation. And that is something that's different as we looked at forgiveness, right? Because reconciliation has to take part on both sides. Forgiveness is one-sided. Reconciliation is both. And so Yeshua's blood, Yeshua's sacrifice, brings that reconciliation where maybe I enjoy just being forgiven prior to that. Now, I have a need for reconciliation, and I'm working towards that reconciliation, and he reconciles himself and myself to him. So next week is our last class. We'll be concluding with a look at the differences between the heavenly tabernacle and the earthly tabernacle, as well as Yeshua's role as the high priest in the order of Melchizedek. We'll see that Yeshua's sacrificial death is not only perfect, as we know, but it's the foundation upon which the Levitical sacrificial system was built, okay? And we'll connect this to Yom Kippur in the conclusion. Any final words?
You're going to have to process all that you just heard, and you may want to go back and re-listen to the audio so that next week when you come, you can have wrestled through all the questions that you don't know you have yet because they're in there, I promise you. And so it would be good to really read through Hebrews and, you know, think about it.
You know, close this.
Any questions or comments?
Okay, you said that Yeshua didn't qualify as a sacrifice because of, you know, the blemish and all the different things. And then you said that the sacrificial system was based upon him.
Exactly.
So that seems like...
Right. So we're gonna talk about this next week when it talks about when there's a change in the priesthood, there's necessarily a change in the law. Okay? And that's going to tie everything together.
Okay. When we start writing in chapter 10, it started talking about the shadow and everything. Hebrews probably is one of the most important books of the Bible, but it's also one of the most poorly translated. It's one of the ones here really was probably most likely written in Hebrew. Then later on, what we actually even have left here is the Greek translation. That's all the manuscripts we have. But when it starts out there talking about shadows here, it's actually the whole emphasis there is that the sacrifice that, you know, not that Yeshua was a sacrifice, but all the sacrificial systems actually pointed there towards Yeshua. That the sacrifices, are, you know, the main purpose of the sacrifices really dealt more even with the temple, and that for you to be able to enter into the temple, you had to have the sacrificial system. It wasn't necessarily as important outside of the temple as this closeness or drawing near into the temple to this one spot on the earth here where it was so important, because the temple is the one area that is inherently holy, not by what happens there, but by just itself. Yeshua here basically was, whenever all these sacrifices here, the fact that there's similarities that all everything here is actually the sacrificial system was actually set up from the very beginning here to point to him. One thing here where I definitely agree, you know, Yeshua definitely does not meet the sacrifices, or it was not a sacrifice. Basically, he was a person, he was a kinsman, more the kinsman redeemer, someone who's paying a debt. It's like if you had got convicted of a crime where you had to serve 40 years, and someone else came in and served the 40 years for you. Mm-hmm. When we basically sin, when we bring in sin, or better yet, you know, when it says that, you know, the bulls, you know, bulls and goats don't remove, never remove sin. It'd be the better translation might be, bulls and goats don't remove the debt of sin, or the penalty of sin, or the consequences of sin, which is the consequences of sin is death. Name one person who did sacrifices of goats and bulls that did not die. Everyone who did those sacrifices, they might have been able to go into the temple, but they still all died. Abraham died, Jacob died, Isaac. Some of the most righteous men in the world died even thought they had made these, you know, these sacrifices, because the sacrifices did not remove the ultimate penalty of sin, which is death. That's what Yeshua is. I mean, well, it will do is pay that penalty here so that we can have, we don't have to experience this second death. We can have that eternal life here. All these sacrifices here, the fact that the there's similarities in the sacrifices, and is to point out that Yeshua was to bring this out, and God arranged that. The one thing here might kind of differ.
Sure.
Is when you were talking about Yeshua here, where I definitely don't agree, the actual, you can lay over the sacrifices here. When Yeshua was on the north side of the temple, that's where he was condemned, where the priest came up there and said, crucify him, crucify him. That was actually the more equivalent to like the cutting of the throat. When he's being flogged here, it's like the cutting up of the sacrifices being carried out to the camp. But again, he wasn't a sacrifice, but it's almost like he's picturing it. It's even the hanging on the cross with the two, thieves. If you looked in the temple when on Passover here, when they had all the animals, the animals were hung on these wooden blocks. Would there be free on either side here? I mean, that's why I had that little gross little thing here with the lambs hanging in my. But I mean, all of that was symbolic here. It stood not that he was a sacrifice, but that he was going to fulfill what. Because I mean, the sacrificial system came in, became necessary, went for us to be drawing near at that temple when we brought sin in.
Just for clarification, the things that Yeshua went through are symbolic and they're pictures, yeah, but they still don't meet the literal requirements.
Yeah, and I mean, that's what actually that very first part of chapter 10 of Hebrews,
right,
of that chapter 10 of Hebrews is saying when it says, these are the shadows of the law here.
Mm-hmm.
It's actually really, if you look at the more, go back to the Greek here and look at the Greek here a little bit, unfortunately it's been translated to meet the theology of the people here.
I'll just say this real quick. You know, many of the early church fathers took everything that was in the Torah of the Old Testament and allegorized it into something that was going to fit with a quote, New Testament theology. Much of the sacrifices are, I mean, much of the Old Testament is viewed that way through the church fathers. What's interesting is that this thing from Hebrews, which is completely allegorical, was in turn taken to be literal. So the thing that should be allegorical, which is Yeshua as a sacrifice, is taken literally, and all the other things are taken. It's like this. David comes to me and says, you know what? Darren gave me he gave me this gift. It's not exactly what I wanted. And I say, David, don't look a gift horse in the mouth. Darren's a horse. Darren's a horse. Tell everybody, Darren's a horse. It's an allegory. It's a statement. And consider, which we haven't even gotten into, the group. Who was Hebrews written to? What were they trying to get their heads around? That they, you know, that there was a challenge within being able to get into the way of being cleansed, that the temple was potentially going to be off limits to them, and they're in crisis of faith. And so there's this allegorical presentation that Yeshua is the ultimate sacrifice, but he's not a sacrifice. I mean, that's what we have to try to get wrapped around. And when you see ultimately the end of the story and how incredibly overarchingly beautiful his sacrifice was from all those considerations. The allegory, the suffering of the righteous, eternal life, covering, atonement, entrance into the Olam Haba, all of it. It's very, very beautifully intense. And that's what we'll try to do. But it will be truly a Nes Gadol if you can do that in 1 week next week. Avinu Shabbat Shemayim, it is a challenge sometimes to confront
dispensations, ideas, and theologies and all this. And so, Father, I pray protection upon each and every one of us as we do look at some challenging considerations. But most of all, I ask, Lord, that you would give us a true divine insight, divine wisdom, divine discernment to really be able to strengthen our relationship through Messiah Yeshua, as he has provided ultimately this covering that allows us to draw near. Teaching and growth should be also an opportunity to draw nearer to you, that our lives would be affected in the real world. So I pray that this class will accomplish that purpose, Father, that every word, that every idea, every concept would be clearly enunciated, clearly received. Father, that you'll give everyone courage to speak over questions and difficulties, and that you will make us stronger, grow us bigger in you, that we might have that external, what's the word I want, that we might be a blessing. That's it, that we might be a blessing to the world. B'Shem Yeshua, amen.